Welcome back to the Rush Hour. My name is Mubarak Mugabo. Now this is the 13th day again, once again, of September 2022. The issues that are still making headlines and the story, the biggest story in the world, is the passing of Queen Elizabeth II. And of course the incoming new King of United Kingdom, that's King Charles III. The discussion around the world is the future, is that an interrogation of the future of the United Kingdom after Elizabeth, but also the future of the Commonwealth and other realms around the United Kingdom and elsewhere in the world, but also most importantly, the future and the roles and relevances of the monarchies in today's world. Now, this is a very interesting discussion that we want to have this morning. Now, joining me to have that discussion are two distinguished experts and also gentlemen who have really had different, very beautiful careers in their respective fields. And that's Honorable John Kenny Ruchamzi, former Member of Parliament. And
The man.
That is your signature.
I beg your pardon, Honorable John Kenny Ruchamzi.
Don't forget that.
The man.
Yeah.
And also Professor Mwambusa Ndevesa, a Makerere Don and a political science lecturer at historian at Makerere University. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining me this morning.
Good morning.
Let me start with Honorable John Kenny Ruchamzi. I know you were in Parliament in 2007 when the Queen Elizabeth visited, and also she had an address in Parliament of Uganda. First of all, how was the feel attending the speech of the Queen firsthand in those chambers?
Yeah, thank you very much. Before I answer that, by coincidence, the name Elizabeth is glorious to me. By coincidence, my mother was Elizabeth before she died. And my daughter is Elizabeth, one of my daughters is Elizabeth Namugabo, so I'm already married to the name.
To the name Elizabeth.
Yes.
Yes.
I was in Parliament as president of the Conservative Party at the time when my daughter was in Parliament, was a member of Parliament. I was invited as a president of a political party to see or to receive the Queen. And in her speech, she did not forget to mention how grateful she was to one of his former prime ministers, the late Winston Churchill, who had mentioned Uganda as the Pearl of Africa. In respect of that, allow me to dedicate a poem from one of my books titled Uganda is Paradise.
Okay.
Uganda is the land of the sun. It is the land of the zebras. It is the land of the lions. It is the pearl of Africa. At the Makshan Falls, when the waters flow, the lions roar, the giraffes yawn, and the rains fall. Uganda is a nation of many nations, with diverse peoples, diverse cultures. The Aru, Pukot, Abanyankole, Abachiga, the Kalamajong. They are also kings. Emori Mori, Umkuka, Wot, Adora, Obusinga, Chavazinga, Abakama, Obutoro, Obunyoro. In Buganda, the Kabaka reigns. He does not rule, but he still commands. They are also birds. The shoe-billed stork, very peculiar bird. The African skimmer, the fish eagle, the crested crane, the crested crane. God save the King of Britain.
Thank you so much for that. Let me just bring in our Professor Mwambusa. What exactly would you say about Queen Elizabeth and what is likely to be the future of the United Kingdom?
Thank you. Queen Elizabeth, I think we have to distinguish between Queen Elizabeth, the persona, and the institution of the monarchy of the United Kingdom, of the British monarchy. Queen Elizabeth as a person, I think she's a decent lady. She was, and she has conducted herself in a manner befitting a royal there, who I think did not become controversial because she's a constitutional monarch and she was not expected to be controversial, but to just represent or be the symbol of a nation. I think there is a sense in which the head of state, she was both head of state and government, but I think in real terms, the head of state is the prime minister and the head of the nation, symbolizing unity, symbolizing culture, the cultural aspects of a nation, was Queen Elizabeth. So that is what I can say about the late Queen Elizabeth. But as far as the institution of the monarchy is concerned, I think it is still relevant, but not so relevant as in the past, because we are living in the 21st century, and I think society has been evolving. The question of monarchs and the queens and the kings and all that has waned. It is not as strong as before. There are those who look at it as a culture of elitism, elitists, or extravagance. You know, somebody owns or is supposed to be in charge of more than 10 castles and the big things there, and a lot of people around her or him and the like. So there is a way in which the monarchy is still relevant, and in another way it is not so much relevant. There are contradictions. There are those still supporting the institution. There are those who are opposed to it. So having been there for many years, being in power for that 70 years, and she refused to actually abdicate in favor of her son, when you stay for a long time, sometimes when you go out of the office, because the office is associated with you, there are likely to be some fissures here and there, because the institution and the persona and the person of the queen had almost become one and the same thing. Yes. Now we are having a new king, Charles, who has a different persona, and we don't know how the institution is likely to evolve around the new king, considering there are controversies. Even in the United Kingdom alone, the Scottish people have been demanding to be autonomous, or actually to be independent of the United Kingdom. This has been reflected in the last referendum they held. About 40% were for going away. And in the Brexit vote, the Scottish actually overwhelmingly voted to remain. That means there are differences within United Kingdom. But even in the Commonwealth, which she has been heading, which is now headed by Charles, there are some contradictions, and especially when it comes to those countries which have been looking at her or as him now as their head of state, the 14 of them or something like that. Some of them are demanding independence away from the monarch in England. One of them prominently being even Australia. It is saying the head of state should be a citizen of Australia, not a citizen of another country. So those are the contradictions
that we are likely to
and
see.
Contestations that are around the monarch, the monarchy, and we don't know how Charles is going to wriggle out of those contestations.
We'll get to that. Honorable John Ken.
Yeah.
It seems to be like those contradictions and controversies around the relevancy and the role of the monarchies in this 21st century is still something that needs to be interrogated. What are your views in those contradictions?
Well, but before I reach there, I'd like to pay tribute to Queen Elizabeth II, because in my capacity as an individual, I possibly would not have been what I am today if I did not belong to the debating society at St. Andrew's College, Kitovu, which debating society was sponsored by the British Council, headed by Queen Elizabeth II. So along those lines, I would like to remember her contribution towards John Kennedy Charles the Man. Putting that aside, I think that we have a lot to learn from the Queen. She was a humble person. Sometimes she spoke with wit to attract her audience. She was also a great lover of nature. And for many years, as you know, my connectivity with the environment, her husband, Philip, was for many years the patron of the World Wildlife Fund for Nature, an international organization which has done so much to protect the environment. As if that was not enough, Queen Elizabeth, though not very political, because she was supposed to be distanced from politics, but she knew how to play her cards. If you are distanced from politics when you are at the same time the chief executive of a nation state, you are the head of state. It means the prime minister rules in your honor, in your name. She knew how to play the cards in terms of leadership. Every year at Christmas time, she would deliver a speech. The speech was related to the environment, to peace and freedom, security, love and joy among nations. That is why when you are making reference to Queen Elizabeth, many of us see or saw her as a global queen. And I think that is why she still commands the love and the sentiments and passion in many people's hearts. Putting that aside, she knew how to play her cards because she was the commander of the British Army. She came in power at a time when the Second World War had just ended. We praise her vision in assisting the rest of the global leaders to transform the League of Nations into the United Nations General Assembly, which is the global government. So many nations were tussling here and there, hitting at one another, but the dilemma of hatred among nations is reducing. As a result of the leadership of great leaders like Queen Elizabeth. You know, she came in power at the time when you had on the one, during the Cold War, you had on the one hand Mao Zedong, you had Joseph Stalin, you had great controversial leaders globally. There was also the tussle of independence for the African continent. And I remember, I have already mentioned that the Queen was ruling through prime ministers. I remember the contribution of the Queen through Alan Macmillan, the Prime Minister of Great Britain in 1960, when he visited the Parliament of South Africa. And I remember, if I may quote what he said, "The wind of change is blowing across the continent. Whether you like it or not, you people in South Africa, change will come, and it is about to come," and it came. Putting that aside, the Queen had a lot of problems. Those cold wars in existence made the Suez Canal area very insecure, and yet the Suez Canal was the global passage of all travels globally. The message she aired through Prime Minister Aden perpetually protected the passage around the Suez Canal, and she won the war against Egypt over the Suez Canal. Putting that aside, we come to Uganda. I am excited that you have invited me to say something about the Queen, because those of you who have read my book, Uganda a creature of the federal doctrine, will understand that I concentrated a great deal about the period of the 1950s. 1953, Sir Edward Mutesa, the Kabaka of Buganda, was exiled in Britain. But before he went, he was deported to Britain, there was a lot of disharmony between himself and the governor, Governor Cowen.
Yes.
Governor Cowen was brutal. And Sir Edward Mutesa, in his book, The Discretion of My Kingdom, at one time said, I nearly finished him.
He was brutal, but he was representing the interests of the
people. Okay, okay. Mm. But I'm saying,
but he was that, aggressive.
That aggressiveness was noted by Queen Elizabeth. You remember when the Kabaka was in exile, it is reported that the circumstances in which he traveled from Entebbe to London were chaotic. It is said that he was covered with a blanket to be transferred to the aeroplane. Otherwise, he had resisted going to the plane.
Honorable, we need actually to move so fast from
now,
that.
The point I wanted to make there was that when Queen Elizabeth realized the brutality of Lord Leighton, the colonial secretary, as well as Cowen, the governor, he transformed the Foreign Office and started sending governors who were friendly. Sir Walter Coutts, who else? Walter Coutts was one of them. Andrew Crawford was one of them. Those governors that came after Cowen were all friendly, and the circumstances of change came because of the leadership of Her Majesty.
Now we are looking at Charles. Look, seems like you're having a very huge history of the Queen. Is Charles actually ready to fit in those big shoes?
As my colleague here said, he has waited for a very long time. But patience pays. The circumstances in which he was welcomed in Scotland excited me and encouraged me.
Encouraged you.
I think he is going to do his best to make sure that he lives to the standards of his mother.
King Charles. Let's look at King Charles. What is the biggest task ahead of him, Professor?
No, thank you. As I had mentioned earlier on, King Charles the third, I hope he will not find the challenges like his great grandfather, the namesake, Charles the first, who was actually beheaded. The one time the King of England was beheaded by Cromwell or somebody like that, but it was Parliament revolting against the executive. Definitely, when you are in such a position, you are likely to court some controversies and contestations, and you have to find ways and means of negotiating through them. But some of the tasks ahead of him is, as I had mentioned earlier on, the question of Scotland, and I think even Northern Ireland. Yeah, Northern Ireland might also want to be independent, just as Scotland has demonstrated. And I don't know what is happening in Wales. United Kingdom, ironically, is not so united as the name suggests. Because even yesterday, when I was listening to the media, the media personnel at times would make a mistake and say the English, and then they say, no, I meant the Scottish. You know, not the Scottish not wanting to be identified as the English. So there is an identity issue. There is an identity contestation within the United Kingdom. And if he doesn't negotiate it very well through skillfully, the United Kingdom may cease to be United Kingdom. You may have England alone and Northern Ireland alone and Scotland alone. Then coming to the Commonwealth, those countries, I have a feeling.
We are going to come to Commonwealth later, but I just wanted to get your views, both of you. The last time we saw, I think the last celebration that Queen Elizabeth had on the throne, we saw banners in the United Kingdom suggesting that a section of citizens in the United Kingdom suggesting that make Elizabeth the last, meaning a section of citizens in the United Kingdom want to do away with monarchies, and they feel they need to concentrate much on the elected government as opposed to the royal family, which actually spend a lot of money onto them from their national budgets. Is this a sign of a diminishing generation, that this generation is no longer interested in monarchies? Honorable John.
Yes, I'm going to comment on that, but before I comment on that, Queen Elizabeth, apart from being the chairperson of the Commonwealth and the head of state of Great Britain, was also head of state for Uganda between 1962 and 1963. And I urge President Yoweri Kaguta Museveni,
he already paid to
though belatedly, he always has some explainable feel about the death of the Queen, because in terms of the flag coming down a little bit.
Flying at half mast. We'll get to that, because it's also another controversy.
But to answer your question, no, the sentiments are zooming all along. For example, the kind of respect and honor which was given to the dead queen in front of her son Charles. In Scotland was indescribable. First of all, Britain is a federation with a bias on confederational interconnectivity. You have Northern Ireland, you have Wales, you have England, you have Scotland.
Yeah.
They enjoy that confederational connectivity, which is very difficult to untie. I tend to think that some of these gimmicks are temporary. You remember, and they depend on the individual politicians. There are some who are much more inflammatory than others. I do not imagine that there is any state, a country which is so connected to freedom as much as Great Britain laid under Queen Elizabeth. You remember, in Scotland, there was a referendum in the past.
Yes.
And everybody thought Scotland was going. It was not going. The Queen was speaking through the Prime Minister to communicate a message. That kind of interconnectivity is not easy, it's so common. We owe a great deal to the Queen and the Great Britain. For example, can you talk about secession in Uganda? But are you aware that under the International Covenant on People's Political, Economic and Social Rights, Uganda signed that International Covenant in 1966, which emphasizes the existence of the right to self-determination. In our constitution, as a lawyer, I have not seen any provision which provides for that right, and yet globally, it is a fundamental right.
So you are saying that the relevance is still there, and these are just temporary hiccups.
Absolutely, but can anybody now speak about, say, Buganda or Bunyoro, that we want to secede? My God,
what are your views, Professor?
To the catastrophe.
Views on what?
On the section of UK citizens who believe that the Queen or the monarch is losing relevance. Last time we saw during her last celebrations where there are posters in the United Kingdom and billboards suggesting that UK should make Elizabeth the last. Does that show a kind of a diminishing relevance to the population?
Yeah, there are those with those sentiments of republicanism within the UK, just like they are everywhere. And that's why I said that the King Charles has to negotiate his reign very carefully, because I think in the minds of the people, they don't see in respect of governance the relevance of the king. But he is still relevant. The monarch is still relevant in at the cultural level. So at the political level, he is more or less not relevant. Just in cases of rituals and formalities, but he's not relevant. And therefore, has to be very careful because the people might be looking at extravagance, and people these days are looking at frugality in management of society, and management of public funds, in management of taxpayers' money. So he has to be very careful there when it comes to his to the budget of royalty, of the monarchy, because that's where people are looking at. But he's still in the hearts of some people because he is symbolic. The office is symbolic, really. It's not functional. It is symbolic. And I'm not saying...
She's the one appointing the prime minister, certainly. It's not
if you have no right to reject what whom you are appointing, then you have no rights at all, actually, even to appoint, because it is the population, it is the citizens to determine which prime minister. Him or her, she could not reject any prime minister. She had no right, she had no powers. So hers was to do something for, it is just a symbolic monarchy, a formality to keep the nation together, although the nation is not together again, you can see the contestation therein.
Mm.
So yes, there are those who would want to have a republic. They may succeed, they may not succeed, but gradually I am also seeing elements of ultra-nationalism or populist nationalism, which might want to revolve around a certain symbol to demonstrate that they are autonomous from the rest of the world, like the Brexit issue and all that. But really, politically, the monarchy is more or less irrelevant. It is still relevant symbolically, culturally.
But
the nation state is both political and cultural. So he could continue, the monarchy can continue playing the role of cultural role. But politically,
it is not relevant at all. Honorable General.
It is the citizens and the Prime Minister who are relevant.
I totally disagree with the professor. First of all, you should be systematic in your analysis.
Okay. Let's hear your systematic analysis.
All the 70 years the Queen has spent on the throne are remarkable years. She has fought many wars. As Commander-in-Chief of the British Army, whenever Britain goes to war, it is Elizabeth in command, if you don't know.
As a head of state.
Commander. Yeah, as a head of state. In no way, she has fought in Falklands, the Falklands War in Argentina. Swiss Canal, Hong Kong, so many wars. I have not heard at any one moment Britain using the forces of nuclear to act against its enemies. That means the monarch is still relevant. It is playing a seemingly small role, but it is not a small role because it has a reserved terrain of controlling the
but
state.
But Honorable John, how
is that even credible? Is that even credible?
On top of that, I'm coming.
That he fought Africans and fought
Let's the point I'm making, as Commander-in-Chief of the British Army, she has been fighting so many wars globally. I have not heard of any scenario where the British forces have applied nuclear to fight its enemies. Lastly, on the same point, is in regard to, for example, the budget. The Republicans are talking about the need to succeed or to do this and that. The British monarch has survived because it has attempted to be accountable. Every year, the Chancellor of the Exchequer knows how much money is coming from the investments of the Queen to sustain the establishment. Nothing is hidden away from the many businesses the royal family has. Unlike many other countries where usually wealth of that kind would be a hidden affair.
What would be her powers if she cannot say no to a prime minister that has been re-elected? What would be her political relevance?
The English say, I think it's Bernard Shaw, there are many ways of skinning a rat. When you are not supposed to do or to practice politics in your governance, there are many ways through which you can silently inject a policy of importance for the good of the country.
is that enough to cause relevancy in the monarchies, especially those who were actually under republics?
The British monarchy has existed for a long time, and there was a time when it shaped events of the day.
Mm.
The monarchy, that is, the institution.
Mm.
Today it does not. It does not shape the events, like international relations.
Mm.
And the Honorable Ken was talking about fighting Falklands, in Falklands and winning a war. But Argentina is not a superpower, was not a great power. And even that one that you are fighting to continue colonizing certain regions of the world is not something to credit UK about, because the empire has been shrinking and fighting in the Suez Canal. Suez Canal, it is Egyptian space, and Hong Kong is Chinese.
Yes.
I don't see how the Great Britain, the one which used to be greater, where the sun will not set, is no longer as great.
The historian expected you
the
to
greatest.
Know.
Let me finish.
He will come.
Yeah, the greatest powers now, the emerging power, is China.
Yes.
Of course, USA is still the greatest.
The greatest, yes.
And you have China in terms of economy. Of course, Germany is still very powerful.
So it is during her reign that actually these other superpowers have emerged over United Kingdom.
Well, after the Second World War,
yes,
these other powers
emerged. That's the era that he has been. Yes.
That's the other powers emerged. It was not. It was no longer the greatest Britain.
Mm.
So I don't think it was because of her.
Mm.
There are other circumstances that emerged, but she's still symbolically relevant.
But not political.
Because of the culture there, but I don't know whether the culture also may not make Britain lag behind to a certain extent. This is debatable, because to be creative and innovative and scientific and otherwise, you need to have freedom sometimes away from traditions, what we call in research orthodoxy.
Yes.
You have to get out of the box.
Mm.
You have to think out of the box, research out of the box, and be free. Sometimes culture can hold you down. It can promote you, it can hold you down. Mm. And as we talk now in the current trajectory, UK is not on top of everything.
How does culture really stop you from growth?
Culture can also affect your mind. Culture is something that affects your thinking. You get it?
Mm.
And the culture might tell you that you should stick to the traditions and not break the traditions. And sometimes breaking the traditions is the way to move.
Mm.
So you must find a way of balancing
culture how
to remain traditional and be modern at the same time.
Exactly.
And at one time, monarchies as custodians of tradition could arrest further development of society.
Mm.
That is not to say that all monarchies have arrested development of society, but that's why they have been evolving in such a way that they don't arrest further development of society, either politically or economically. So that's why I'm saying, to a certain extent, the monarchy can hold the country together, which is positive,
yes.
But they can also hold down further development of society, both as individuals and as a nation.
That's Professor
The professor should know that power, being a very important aspect of life, political life, should be sieved, should be checked. That is why federal governance globally is an important matter, because before you reach the upper decision or the final decision, you have circumstances of checks and balances here and there. When I was doing research in writing my book, Uganda is a Creature of the Federal Doctrine, I realized that, and I found that Margaret Thatcher, who was a very controversial
Prime Minister,
was checked by Queen Elizabeth over the application for South Africa to buy weapons. The Queen said, no, that country is still in chaos. We should not be identified as people supporting them.
Secondly, when you talk about annexation, at one time, political annexation of nations or countries was an order of the day. Columbus is one of those people who we say to have gone around the world, is it?
Mm.
Yeah? But it is also common knowledge that even Buganda, my kingdom, had to conquer certain states to be where it is now.
Mm.
So when you talk about conquests, they are not a new phenomenon, Professor. At one time, that was the order of the day. You had to conquer other nations to expand and make a framework of existence.
The order of the day.
Honorable, by that, yeah. Because the professor is saying that it is during her time that actually these other superpowers took over. And the argument of culture, you know, hindering development is a fact.
When they take over, eventually they are coming back to her. To a political terrain. For example, the United States of America started off its struggle against Queen Victoria in opposition for paying taxes without being represented in the House of Commons. Eventually, they declared independence in 1776. Later on, as a result of development, they came to surpass Great Britain, but in the end, without forgetting that Great Britain is still useful to them.
We need actually to come to an end of this discussion, but before we do that, we have to talk about the issue of the controversy surrounding the mourning of the Queen. There are many former colonies of the Great Britain that feel the Queen shouldn't be mourned because of the atrocities committed by the Great Britons in these former colonies. We saw a statement coming in from Julius Malema, the leader of the Economic Freedom Fighters in South Africa, saying that there is no need for former colonies actually to mourn the Queen. Let me start with you, Professor. Should there be a mourning in these African countries? Because some African countries have even decided to leave their flags to fly at half-mast, while others have not given that direction. Should there be a need for mourning?
That is a very important question, and which Ken pointed out also to the extent that he almost was an apologist of imperialism and colonialism. That we should have been annexed, that is okay. I think that is the question of colonialism and imperialism and neocolonialism now and hegemony. And those who are expressing those sentiments, like those ones of Malema, they are the other side of the coin that you see. We are against the atrocities committed in the past. So this is one way of expressing the atrocities committed by Imperial Britain, which should be remembered, so that they are not repeated by any other country or in a different form. Mm. And therefore, that is not credit to imperialism or to the British colonialism.
Mm.
There are also those who are expressing sentiments that we are part and parcel of the global world, and we cannot wish away the legacy of that imperial rule.
Mm.
We can't wish away. You can see we are speaking English,
yes,
language, and there are certain things that we share in common with UK, and we are in the British Commonwealth. We are trying to promote international understanding. So we can actually, culturally, in according to our traditions, we can still mourn the death of the Queen, but that should not stop us again also pointing out the atrocities, the negative aspects of imperial rule, which was, of course, it was authoritarian.
Mm.
Of course, many people lost their lives. Others lost their sovereignty around that time. So in history, we should recognize and appreciate that imperial rule was authoritarian, was brutal. He talked about brutality.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, he was saying that Governor Cohen was brutal. By the way, Governor Cohen was progressive.
Mm.
Of all the governors that ruled Uganda, Governor Cohen was progressive, and he belonged to the progressive wing.
And aggressive.
Yes, aggressive, but he was progressive at the same time. In fact, he was he is the one who somehow allowed space for economic freedom in Uganda and the economic participation of Ugandans in the trade, He's the one who started actually this commercial bank which was sold. It was called African Savings and Credit Bank. He's the one who gave some space and room for cooperatives to start in Uganda. Governor Cohen is the one who started schools that were not controlled by the church. That, like in Ntare, I think Butobere, I think Teso College, or something like that. So Governor Cohen actually put us on the road to independence because he was from the progressive wing of the of the Labour Party in UK.
Then you are contradicting yourself.
No, I'm not. Governor Cohen was from the Labour Party. He was progressive.
So he was although the African continent and the former colonies have a cause to, because there are good things that the colonists did here, but also we should also not fail to
let me put it that way. This is a very interesting discussion. I will put it like this. You know, when you are feeding a cow, or when you are feeding an animal, whatever, on your farm, it is benefiting, isn't it?
Yes.
But is it for its own good?
It's for your own good.
You are doing it.
You are doing it to make it.
So it is incidental. We are not saying that progressive, like for example, technological forces, forces of production, that came with education and technology that the imperial rule brought here, is irrelevant. It is relevance. It put us to a certain
level,
a higher level than where we were.
Yeah, yes.
So that is appreciated. But the question is
the
intent
of it
was like when you are feeding a cow, and then you are
to slaughter it to
not
at the end of the day.
You are feeding a cow for its own good.
All level John can
and therefore, if the cow had a conscience, it would not give.
It would not even feed. Because if you know that at the end of the day, after feeding,
because even when you are under slavery, you feed, or when you are in Israel, you still feed. It would still feed, but it would know that the intention of that person feeding
to
me,
was to take me to the slaughterhouse.
The professor is forgetting my character sketch in Uganda between 1961 and 1967. When the quasi-federal arrangement was still at play, Uganda had the best outstanding GDP in the region. The point I want to make is that it is we people in Africa, for example, that damaged the opportunities that existed, especially when we got overexcited about the phenomenon of the East-West divide. You remember Professor Ali Mazoi, after the introduction of the Common Man Charter by Milton Obote, Mazoi said, Milton Obote is a good African, but is a great leader with great mistakes. Those mistakes came because he got too excited about the Eastern Bloc that was basing everything on the East. And it is the British government and other related governments that balanced that phenomenon to rescue us from the phenomenon of communism. Otherwise, we would be a communist entity.
No, so Honorable John, so should we say that those who actually are saying that we shouldn't mourn the Queen don't have a point?
No, those
because of
say,
the atrocities that the colonists committed here.
We shouldn't mourn the Queen do not have a point. For example, take the case of Malema of South Africa. Why is he where he is? He's where he is because the ANC misbehaved and started going astray.
But how are you relating that one? Can I come in?
Yes.
Why did it go astray? It is because he wanted to commit the same mistakes those apartheid leaders were doing.
Oh, professor.
And in the same vein, let me conclude my point. In the same vein, President Yoweri Kaguta Museveni went to the bush. We all gave him support. When he came back from the bush, he's repeating the same mistakes he did that he forced him to go to the bush. Why does the professor see that point?
So in other words, you are saying that those who are saying we shouldn't mourn the Queen don't have a sense.
They don't have a point.
They don't have a point.
Yeah.
Professor, you wanted to come in.
No, I wanted to come in about the greatest mistakes, communism, whatever. There are very many issues that you did mix here. But the point I wanted to make is that development can take place under different traditions. We don't have to follow one tradition, whether it is federal or Republican, or whether it is conservative, whether it is capitalist or whatever. I mean, you seemed to be against the political order or the economic order under certainly different systems. I mean, China has now risen almost it is above UK now.
How has it risen?
It has risen. It has risen under socialism, under
communism,
under different arrangement. It is not under the monarchy. It is not under.
Is it about the circumstances or just
the context? We are saying there are unique contexts to different countries.
The first causes debt burdens in Africa before it raises.
No. Actually, it is UK which exploited Uganda and other dependencies in order to rise. It is not China which exploited us.
So in other words, that discussion continues, especially the discussion to do whether African former colonies should have a cause to mourn the Queen or not. But that's actually a discussion.
Does UK mourn the people it killed in Africa during colonialism and during the decolonization period? The Mau Mau people, are they mourned? The Herero and Nama in Namibia, even Ugandans who were killed during those wars. Did UK mourn Mwanga, who was exiled and had to die in such islands?
No, all those people who went as Abaseveni have been rewarded.
By what?
By the British government.
How did they?
My grandfather was.
Let me tell you, your great grandfather even died long ago. Let me say this right here.
Of course, he's supposed to have died long time ago.
He's supposed to have died long time ago.
Of the Second World War. No, let me say this one, which is going to shock both of you.
Yes.
I, Mwambusia Debesa, still have my father, Elisa Ruhebiahu, a Second World War veteran. 104 years old, he's still alive. Wow. And he did not benefit from that war because even his war gratuities did not reach him. Exactly.
We have to wind up this discussion. I couldn't actually let you go before you comment about monarchies which are actually existing in the republics like Uganda, what should be their role and what should be their limits? John Kenny Luchams.
Their limits. First of all, Uganda should not be what it is without those kingdoms. They played a very important role at independence and before independence. This country should not be talked about without them. They should not forget that they still have a role to play, especially when they are given the opportunity to do so on the basis of a federal system of government. Kenya, our neighbors, are a quasi-federation now. Tanzania is a federation, United Republic of Tanzania. So I think we should not lose hope about the dictatorial tendencies surrounding President Museveni now. There are many opportunities of correcting the errors so that we go back to where we are supposed to.
Republics, I don't know, monarchies under republics. What should be their role and what should be their limits?
Well, their limits should be cultural, where they play that meaningful role, where they can use their cultural mobilization to promote their communities in that regard. But they should not overstep their bounds into politics. However, it is inevitable that they would be politicized because even those who are in charge of the state as Republicans, they also use them opportunistically. And as much as the cultural leaders also use those in power opportunistically. So anyway, these are contradictions that happen in society. Traditional leaders or cultural leaders or monarchies can exist, but they will always raise contestations.
Yes.
There will always be contestations between different arrangements of society. They can play a role of that cultural. I don't know whether they play the role of cultural cohesion or society of cohesion, because where the kingdoms have been reinstated in Uganda, they have not necessarily brought unity of those communities, because we have had some skirmishes here in Buganda, there are skirmishes in Busoga, they are there in Toro, they are there in Rwenzori, they are there in Bambasawa, they are there even up to Lango, they are there among the Bagwere, as much as there could be skirmishes elsewhere. They are institutions of society, they can be tolerated, but if at times even within themselves they cause controversies, then there is a republic now, which can now mediate the conflicts between those republicans and the monarchists, or the culturalists, the traditionalists, and the modernists. There will always be controversies here and there. He's talking, I want to comment on the question of federalism. Federalism, which depends on the nature of federalism. It is neither here nor there. There can be unity and progress under federalism, or there can be under development under federalism. There can be conflicts under federalism. For example, we have federalism in
Kenya.
There is no federalism in Kenya. Majimbo is
federalism in Kenya.
But let's not debate Kenya, because I know Kenya is not a federal state, but there is federalism in Ethiopia, but there is conflict. There is federalism in Nigeria. There is conflicts. There is federalism in the USA. Somehow united. So the question of federalism or no federalism is not necessarily.
We have to get out of this place.
One minute.
I want to correct the professor. I say the Kenya is a quasi federation. Do you understand by what do you understand by quasi federation?
So how do you become?
So you are literally saying that
the counties have powers and they are given money direct from parliament to do their business.
That is a decentralization.
No. They have got a house, a senate. They are represented in the senate. So I am talking sense.
Yeah, but
quasi federation means quasi federation.
Thank you so much.
So quasi republic means quasi republic.
Gentlemen, we can't go beyond.
So Uganda is a quasi republic.
We can't go beyond.
The monarchies in Uganda.
Professor, we can't go beyond
Republicans.
We can't go beyond this discussion. Thank you so
don't
much.
Don't joke as an agent.
It's been a discussion to do with monarchies and the roles and the relevance of the monarchies after Queen Elizabeth II. It's been actually a very good discussion between the Honorable John Kennedy Chams, the man, who is a former member of parliament, and also Professor Ndevesha Mwambusa, who is a Makerere historian.
And the one for justice. I stand for justice.
Yes.
These others are by the ways.
We are going to take a very short break. We are returning with the memories of the Queen's visit in Uganda. The Right Honorable Margaret Natongo Ziwa, who is a former member of the East African Legislative Assembly. She was in Parliament when the Queen visited here in Uganda and, of course, addressed Parliament. We just want to get a feel of exactly what happened and the memories that actually they have during the Queen's visit. My name is Mubarak Mugabe. We are taking a break.